Tonight's speaker is George Diggs, and he's talking on the Blackland Prairie across time. He's a evolutionary biologist, botany professor at Austin College in Sherman. George has taught at Austin College for more than 40 years, is also a research associate at Britt in Fort Worth, the Botanical Research Institute of Texas, that is. He has a real diverse research interests, including the plants of Texas, evolution as it relates to human health, and biogeography. He's co-authored four books and more than 30 scientific articles. In addition, George helped found the public health program at Austin College and teaches environmental and evolutionary health, including the impact of diet and toxins on human health. So
I'm going to talk about the Blackland Prairie across time. And I think that's an important aspect because, you know, we're at one point in time, we can go back in time, we can project into the future. And I think that gives us a better idea overall. So most of us live on the Blackland Prairie. If you live in Collin County, you obviously live on the Blackland Prairie, unless you're in a stream bottom, and then you live on some sand, but not many people live there. And so I'm going to talk about what, where, and why it is, and then a little bit about the soils, connections to the past, and then end up just briefly a little bit about possible future of the Blackland Prairie. So it's a beautiful ecosystem. Some people think prairies are not nearly as nice as forests, but hey, what's not to love about a nice prairie, particularly at some times of the year? And kind of locating it where it's at, Blackland Prairie is located, it's kind of sandwiched between two areas of forest. And that's interesting because we get rainfall decreasing as we go west. So you would think you would eventually move from forest and you'd get into grassland, but that's not what we see. We have forest and grassland and forest and grassland. And a little further south, we have different bands. So we have multiple bands of forest, grassland, down the southern part of the Blackland Prairie. So that's interesting. And there's an explanation for that that I'll show you in just a minute. So we have three parts to the Blackland Prairie, the main body here, and then a little snippet, not much left of that, called the Fayette Prairie, and then something called the String or San Antonio Prairie. And they're surrounded by this coast-oak savanna. Now, this is a satellite image of the area, and you can kind of tell where the Blackland Prairie is. Can everybody kind of get a sense? You can kind of tell, even though a lot of trees have invaded, you can still tell that this is something different. So I kind of find that interesting, even though humans have modified the landscape a tremendous amount since settlement, it still is something that can be seen from a long way up. So why is it here? Well, we're on an ecotone or an ecological transition zone between the grasslands of central North America and the deciduous forest of eastern North America. So we're at that interface. But it's more complicated than that. It does have moderate rainfall. So the moderate rainfall means there's enough rain for trees, but trees don't grow everywhere. So why? Well, the why is the soil. And so the particular soil here under the Blackland Prairie, when combined with the fire regime and the amount of rainfall, means that on these clay soils, we end up with prairie. Whereas on adjacent sandy soil, with same rainfall, basically, you end up with forest, which is not tall forest, but it's forest. And so it's this combination of factors. So the soil is really the key at the end of the day. The soil is key to why we have the prairie here and why it's not just continuous trees, because you can drive a long way west of here and you still have trees in the West Cross Timbers, even though they get shorter and shorter and shorter. Jeff lives over near Fort Worth. And there's trees over there, right, Jeff? In fact, there's trees a long way west of Fort Worth. But So it's not just rainfall. Soil is a big thing. Okay, so thinking about soil, let's go back 100 million years. I said we're going to go through time. I meant it. We're going back a long way. About 100 million years ago, this area was underwater. All of this area was underwater. And depending on exactly where you are in this part of Texas, the rock layers are slightly older or slightly younger, and they vary from some of them have, the layers have large fossils, things like the large ammonites. Some are more sandy, but all of this area was underwater. And that's when the clay soils, the clay rocks were laid down that eventually weather into the Black Prairie soil. So we can go anywhere in North Central Texas, and if you know where to look, you're going to find fossils. I mean, we could go out here, dig a hole, and we'd get up Austin chalk. It's a white rock, and they're not big fossils usually in the Austin chalk. You find them occasionally, but all you need is look at it under a microscope, and there's fossils of sea creatures. In some places, I've seen fossils of ammonites locally that are so big I couldn't pick them up. They weigh, I don't know, they're bigger than I can carry. What can I say? And this affects the soil because that rock breaks down and forms this black, waxy limestone clay soil. So this is a picture taken on the Austin College campus a number of years ago when they were digging trenches to put in fiber optic network across the campus. And it was, to me, it was a fantastic, you know, it was very disruptive on the campus, but for me, it was a fantastic opportunity because the campus had never been plowed. That was area that was had never been plowed. And when I first came there 40 some years ago, there was still some native grass on there, just some little buffalo grass and a few native plants were still hanging on in parts of the campus. They're all gone now with irrigation. But when they dug down under this black waxy, black clay, Blackland soil, the rock right underneath was that white Austin chalk limestone. And it's shockingly different, right? Now, you might say, well, why does it break down into such, why is it the soil so black? And that's because it's been under prairie grass and the roots go deep. Some of you who work with native plants know that some of our native grasses can send roots down at least 6 feet. They go quite deep. And as the roots
you can stay near the mic.
Sorry. I need to chain myself to the podium here. As roots die and as microorganisms and other organisms work the soil, the organic matter gets incorporated and it turns the soil very black. So you get the clay minerals from this limestone clay soil, from limestone clay bedrock, then mixed with all the organic matter from the prairie soil, and you get this wonderfully rich soil, some of the richest anywhere. It's got different names, black waxy, black gumbo, black velvet. That's one that I've never heard anybody say, but you look it up and some people apparently call it that. I don't know. Has any of y'all ever heard that term? I don't know where they say that, maybe somewhere further south. For one thing, this is sticky stuff. So any of you who live here know that if you go out on the Blackland Prairie soil and it's damp, you're going to come away with clumps of mud on your feet. The first thing you have to do if you're working in a garden or something is you make paths so that you don't constantly have to clean your shoes. Also, as you know, there are cracks. Sometimes the cracks are almost big enough to get a tennis ball. I mean, you can lose things down these cracks. People can sprain an ankle or an animal can hurt their ankle. I don't know. Friend, have horses ever hurt themselves on these? Yeah. I'm not surprised. Mm-hmm. Interesting. Yeah. So the soil shrinks and swells, and that's a reflection of the special type of clay mineral. So the clay mineral contributes to this shrink swell nature. We all know what this does to houses if you build a house here, in the past, people didn't understand this so well. Now, if you build a house, you sink these big piers down to, you actually get down to the Austin Chalk, and that keeps the foundation from shifting. But almost all houses here that are very old have cracks either in their sheetrock or in their bricks. And the doors, I know at my house, different times of the year, the door likes to close better than it does at others. Nobody else has experienced that, right? Certainly not. So that's these clay minerals. Now, this has an effect at the micro level, and it has a long-term effect on many, many things. There's a phenomenon known as gilgai, G-I-L-G-A-I. And so let's imagine we have the soil, and here is a crack, and here's another crack. Okay, so the soil cracks. And when it gets dry, it can get pretty wide, and then chunks fall from the surrounding area into that crack, okay? So now you've got more stuff at the bottom of the crack than there was previously. When it rains, so you've got this stuff down in there. When it rains, everything then swells. The soil literally swells up, and it doesn't take long for the crack to close. But now you've got more stuff down in the crack than there used to be, so you've got pressure. And so over decades, the soil kind of churns, okay? So there's a movement. And that churning causes some weird surface features. It causes these basins that are several meters across, these basins that are shallow, but they have little rims. And if you're walking across undisturbed Blackland Prairie and it's on a flat area, you'll go into this little basin. You know, literally, it's only like 6 inches or something. You'll go in a basin, you'll out of a basin. Go into a basin, out of a basin. How many of you have noticed this on the spirit tour? A lot of you, right? So this is called gilgai. Now, yeah, and that's due to this churning. And by the way, there was a very knowledgeable soil scientist at A&M named Fred Smimes, who he's probably passed away now because he was a lot older than me, and I knew him 30, 40 years ago. He said that Blackland Prairie soils would reestablish gilgai over many decades. So if the soil had been plowed, you'd destroy the gilgai. But if you don't disturb it again for many decades, that this churning will reestablish the gilgai. Now, the gilgai, and by the way, these are called, some people call them hog wallows. Well, there were no hogs here, you know, in pre-modern times. So hogs had nothing to do with it, but they're called hog wallows. And on sloped ground, they form micro valleys. So they're little micro mountains and micro valleys. Again, only a few inches high, but you can actually see this. And I took this picture in Northern Grayson County a number of years ago, and this is on a slope. And you can see another thing that's associated with this, and one of the interesting things plant-wise, in the micro valleys or in the little rims of gilgai, you have different native plants that specialize in growing there. Whereas in the middle of the gilgai and in the little valley itself, you have different native plants that are specialists there. So over a matter of just a few inches, you get different plant compositions. And I used to take a class out, and we would do species counts. I'd have them count the number of plants, different species that were growing on the rim of gilgais, and then the ones that were down in the basin, and it was dramatically different. This is also fascinating from the standpoint of the early settlers. Because most of this area was flat, when it rained, and keep in mind, this soil is pretty sticky, right? When it rained, these gilgai would capture water. And so the water, in flat areas, the water wouldn't run off. And so you'd have the water captured. And you can imagine if you were trying to go anywhere in a wagon, what that would be like. First, you're bumping over the gilgai, and then you're probably, well, what can I say? People would get isolated because transportation was very difficult. Okay. Now, one of the things that the soil ended up allowing to happen, because of the soil, we would have grassland. Grasses would be preferred over some of the trees, but then these grasses would be a lot of standing biomass, and so fire would go across these prairies at regular intervals. And if you read some of the pre-settlement accounts of fire in this part of Texas and adjacent parts of Texas, some of these fires could be astonishing. They would burn over tens of miles. Buffalo herds would be impacted. Bison would be, get caught on fire, and they'd be running. I mean, read the early accounts. It's really something. Recurrent fire was a big deal. Today, and we still use fire as a control mechanism here. Austin College has a course that's taught every other January where our students do control burns on a prairie restoration site. And we're very careful. The students have to wear fire gear. This doesn't show it there. That was one of the early years, but now we're really serious, and they're trained well as a local fire company comes, because even on a small prairie, I've seen this, you can't believe just on a few acres, fire can sweep across, and it can be pretty scary. Has anybody been involved in a controlled prairie burn? It can be surprising, can't it? You've got to have a good mode perimeter, and you've got to back burn. There's a lot to it, but you have to somehow keep woody plants from invading, because if you don't have grazing, you don't have fire, you don't have some other disturbance, it will grow up because there's plenty of moisture here. Bush hogging is something that's often used locally. That's what I do at my property. And I think Bill and Fran, y'all bush hog as well, don't you? So when the soil type is combined with the amount of rainfall, result was the Blackland Prairie. So we are living in kind of a ecosystem here that is right on the edge of stability. And when humans came in, when Europeans came in and stopped the fires, then we've gotten the Blackland Prairies growing up. Particularly one of the biggest pests here are red cedars, which is a native plant. And I fight red cedars like they're the devil incarnate. Some of y'all do too. So we have to have some type of disturbance. Otherwise, it'll be invaded by woody plants and lost. Okay. Now, when we talk about the Blackland Prairie, I have to talk about this plant, which is not a native plant, but it's why we are sitting here today. We probably, none of us would be here if it wasn't for this plant, and this is cotton. And this was the economic engine for Texas, and cotton was grown on the very rich Blackland Prairie soil. So this soil was incredibly rich. There's a line of the way this is showing that got cut off. But if you look at the line of cities, major cities in Texas, if you go from Sherman to Dallas to Waco to Austin to San Antonio, all of those cities are in a line right down the Blackland Prairie. And that's because that's where cotton gins would be located. And that's where a lot of the money in early Texas came from. Now, there are some other big cities in Texas, for example, Houston. Well, there's an obvious reason why that was there, right? It was a port. But many of the early cities in Texas were right in this line down the Blackland Prairie. And it was, if you read back the stories, it was called King Cotton because that was the economic driver for the state at one time. Now, let's look at some other connections to the past. Went back 100 million years. Go back a little less now. If we look at the period 10,000 to 20,000 years ago, that was at the end of the last glacial period. And there were very different conditions here as well as in the rest of North America. Glaciers covered the northern part of the U.S. and Canada. So glaciers came down into the Ohio River Valley. Now, glaciers didn't get down here, but the temperature was very different, right? And the vegetation was very different. And there were a huge number of large animals right here, right where we're at. Some of the plants that are still in Texas today were here. Many of them are not here anymore. There were spruce, for example, here. They're not here. Jack in the Pulpit, Jeff was telling me, he was over at Mineral Well State Park, and there's a colony of Jack in the Pulpit there in the bottom of one of these rock crevices. Now, Jack in the Pulpit still occurs in Far East Texas where it's wet, but there's a colony over in Mineral Wells where it's dry. You get up out of that little crack in the rocks, and there's cactus, a bunch of different cactus species growing there. The various types of both the pad type opuntia and also the cylindrical type of opuntia. Well, that colony there has probably survived since glacial times. But most of the animals that were here, the large animals, are now gone. So this shows North America. That shows a 40 degree latitude, and you can see there were glaciers all down here, not this far, but climate was very different. So changes in vegetation and changes in animal life. So this area was swarming with big creatures: mammoths, mastodon, ground sloth, giant bison, giant beaver, extinct horses, saber-toothed cats, and all of these went extinct somewhere 10 to 12,000 years ago. And that was almost surely caused by a combination of the climate was changing, but almost surely caused in a big way by overhunting, because climate had changed many times in the past and the population survived. Their numbers were reduced, but they survived. But this last time was after humans got here and they basically wiped out the large animals. I just wanted to mention a couple of them, because I get excited by thinking about some of these things in the past. A giant beaver, that shows compared to about a 6 foot person, these things could get up to more than 250 pounds. Can you imagine what that thing would do to a forest? The streams, it would have been shocking. There was a saber-toothed cat in this area. Smilodon is the genus. They got up to 660 pounds. That's bigger than any modern cat. That's, you know, more than 100 pounds bigger than the largest lions. And they had incisors, they were called saber-tooth for a reason. Those incisors were 8 inches long. And they would,
I
was going to go over and bite Betsy. But they would go over, they would actually sink these things into the neck of their prey. And apparently, biologists think happened, they would bite them and then they would just pull those giant incisors out and let the prey bleed out. There's no need to fight the prey. The prey, you know, it's like getting two giant knives shoved into your neck and they would bleed out. So very different creatures here. Mammoths, for example, Austin College group of students did a dig in Grayson County a number of years ago. We've got some of the fossils in a cabinet on the campus, a big mammoth found in Grayson County. So it was a pretty different place. I'm also, ground sloths are something that get my attention. These can weigh several thousand pounds. How many thousand pounds below there, but it doesn't show up in this view. These probably had profound effect on the local vegetation. They probably did what elephants do in Africa today. Elephants really change the vegetation. Trees can't grow up in many places because elephants simply will rip the bark off using their tusks. I mean, you can see a tree. I've been there and looked at it. The bark is off of many trees up high as an elephant can rip the bark off because they rip the outer bark and then they eat the inner bark. And small trees, they just push over. Sloths were probably doing equivalent things. I always grin when I see artist renderings like this, where it looks like the sloth is delicately getting a few leaves and it's using its tongue. Yeah, you know, something that weighs 2,000 or 3,000 pounds. They're messy eaters. You know, they were hard on plants. So, did this megafauna, so we call this the megafauna, big animals, did this shape the plants of this area? So that's an interesting question. Plants and animals shape each other, right? All of us know about pollinators. So many flowers have a long tube, and the thing that pollinates them often have a long mouth part or a long beak, right? So plants and animals have evolved with each other. And indeed, there are plants here that we can still see the signature of these extinct animals in their structure, which to me is fascinating. 10,000 years is nothing in terms of evolution, is it? So there's a famous paper a number of years ago, and we have a number of plants living in this area, and there are many others in various parts of North and Central and South America that we can call anachronisms. These are plants that were living then, and that still show some of these ancient characteristics. I like to call them a couple of names. There's a book on this. They're called The Ghost of Evolution. I like to call them living shadows of the evolutionary past. You can call them whatever you want. You know two of these plants only too well, I guarantee. Oh, by the way, this is an elephant. You can see where the elephants have knocked the bark off up to about here. See how different that is? And then here's trees. They literally just knock over sizable trees. They want to eat, so they just knock them over. So we see reflections of these extinct animals in at least two trees. I think I could list more, but at least two that grow along the streams in the Blackland Prairie. One of them is the bodart, and the other one is the honey locust. So here's bodart. We all know bodart. It's called, some people call it horse apple, and that fruit is too large for anything living here today to eat. Okay. Now, animals will eat it. I've done the experiment. My neighbor has a horse, it's a large horse, and the horse likes bodark apples. And so, but I went up one day and I asked my neighbor, it's okay if I feed Brandy bodark apple. I just wanted to see how she ate it. And I gave it to Brandy. Brandy was my friend. Brandy just opened her mouth. She bit right down on that thing. One piece shot out of her mouth. She chewed the piece up in her mouth, and she went over and got the other piece. Did y'all's horses ever eat bodark apple? Yeah. And so these resemble the kinds of fruits you see in Africa, where elephants eat these things, right? I mean, the only place on Earth where these big animals survive now in any numbers is Africa, and we still see this similar kinds of things there. These trees are heavily armed. They have bodarks. The sprouts are one of the most dangerous things I have to deal with. I have to clear some land, and bodark will really hurt you because the spines are not too long, but gosh, there's tough. Bill is nodding. You've probably had your skin and your clothes ripped. Yeah, they're tough. So the fruit of the plant is attractive to the big creatures, but the plant has to protect itself from these same creatures because otherwise the creature would eat the leaves and knock the tree over. Well, that's not going to happen. Honey locust is even more extreme. The fruits of honey locusts are also edible. Now, I used to have my students taste honey locust fruits. At the right time of the year, those fruits have a strip of tissue along one edge that has a raisin-like taste. I don't recommend it because it has a nasty aftertaste. How many of you have tasted this? Anybody? Fran has? Yeah. Isn't it kind of raisin-like? Use your imagination. But boy, I don't like that aftertaste. But for an animal, it would be, you know, it's sweet. It's literally sweet. But honey locust has incredible armature. There are these thorns that come out. They can get 9 to 12 inches long. They're branched. And they literally could be mounted and used as a weapon. I have no doubt that if you took a big one, you could kill something like a deer if with it. I had one stuck in my knee once when I was using a chainsaw. And boy, that ended the day's work. I can tell you that. And in fact, I had just the other day a honey locust thorn stuck into a boot. And I felt, fortunately, it was a short one. And my foot felt funny. It wasn't sticking in, but its foot felt like something's right with this shoe. And I looked up and there was a thing stuck right in my shoe. And I thought, boy, I was lucky that wasn't any longer. How many times has that happened to you?
Well, you know, back when we first had the property, we probably cleared about 2,000, 3,000 honey locusts. And I've been having some knee pain. My knee was swelling up, but I didn't know why. And I took a close look, and there was a honey locust thorn had probably been in there for 2 or 3 weeks. Yeah. It got better once I pulled it out.
Yeah. So, but these trees, there's nothing here now. Why would a tree in this ecosystem grow thorns that long? That's a tremendous waste of energy. But it wasn't a waste of energy in the past. It was crucial for its survival. There's another one, by the way. Some of you may know the tree. Xanthoxylum is the genus. It's called tickle tongue, prickly ash. And it's got, its trunk has these things sticking out of it. And also the leaves are prickly. And the foliage is full of a chemical that will numb your mouth. And I think it wouldn't probably do for an animal to eat too much of that. Yeah, because natives used to chew it because it numbs the mouth. So, you know, we see these excessive defenses, these nonsensical fruits. There are missing partners, right? They're missing their partner. They're missing the sloths. They're missing the elephants that were here, the giant elephant relatives that were here. These are natural whispers from the past. You know, you, next time you see a bodark or a honey locust, you just think, I'm actually looking into the past. It's kind of exciting, actually, you know, because some things change rapidly, but some things we see this stuff held over. Okay. One thing that always shocks me when I think about pre-settlement times is that this area was only settled about 200 years ago. So if you think back, this is 2020, okay? If you go back 100 years, 2024, you go back 100 years, that's 1924. You go back another 100 years, that's 1824. That was before Collin County, I think, was founded. I don't know what year Collin County was founded. Grayson County was being settled in the 1840s. It hasn't been that long. My father died at 94, and you know, that's one human's life, and you know, that's nearly half the time that this area has been settled. It's shocking what humans have done in a matter of a couple of long human lifetimes. And go back 200 years and everything here except the long stream bottoms, everything was Blackland Prairie. I was involved in a book project years ago, and the preface, or the, I forget what the page is at the front of the book that, where you give a quote, but I found this wonderful quote. It was in the in a letter at the at a museum in Sherman, and this was a letter that was sent by a man who settled in Grayson County. He walked to Grayson County. He was from England originally. He came over, he got to Shreveport, and he and a companion were walking here to settle, and his companion died along the way, and he got to Grayson County in the 1840s. And this is a quote. He said, and he settled in southern Grayson County, so it's not far from here, right? Very southern part of Grayson County, just north of the county line. I can sit on the porch before my door and see miles of the most beautiful prairie interwoven with groves of timber, I presume on the streams, surpassing in my idea the beauties of the sea. Think of seeing a tract of land on a slight incline covered with flowers and rich meadow grass for 12 to 20 miles. So basically, as far as he could see, this is grass, sea of grass with, you know, streams having some trees. It really would have been something just 200 years ago. This is the, having some weird stuff going on here. I don't know why that's showing up. This is the cover we had painted for a flora. And this was our artist's rendition of the Blackland Prairie. And it's kind of fun. That's a little herd of buffalo there. A few little buffalo the artist put in. And this, of course, is one of our wonderful native wildflowers. I don't know of any locations in Collin County. I think it's been totally extirpated from here. There could be some here, but I don't know if there is. Yeah. And I've only been able, and I've been in Grayson County a long time, and I've been over most of the county. I found one colony in Grayson County, and it's in a basically a bluff above the Red River. And, you know, it's almost been totally wiped out here. So what were some of the creatures here? Well, again, if you read the historical accounts, right here we had large herds of buffalo, right here. You don't have to go south. You don't have to, you know, I'm talking about right up here in this part of the Blackland Prairie, large herds of bison. We had pronghorn antelopes. There's an account in Fannin County. Well, people say they were further west. Fannin County is not further west of us, right? Andrew, you're not too far from Fannin County, but you're still west of Fannin County, right? You're in, you are in Fannin County. Yeah. So this would have been probably just south of where you're at, because you're in the transition zone. So it would have probably been a few miles from y'all's property. And these babies could run up to about 70 miles an hour. Now you might think, okay, why would an animal run 70 miles an hour? Okay. This is it. When you look at a pronghorn, you're also looking at something out of the past, okay? There was an American cheetah. Cheetahs are fast. The pronghorn co-evolved with the cheetah. There's a reason why pronghorns are so fast. There's nothing here now that can catch a pronghorn. There used to be. There were prairie chickens. There were black bears. There were gray wolves. There were mountain lions and even jaguars. And by the way, you occasionally hear of a mountain lion in this area still. There was one in Mineral Well State Park. There was a record of one maybe 10 or 15 years ago. And there's been some sighted up in Grayson County up along the river. Rattlesnakes, they're now rare. Passenger pigeons, probably the most abundant bird in the world around 1800. There were huge flocks here, including Grayson County. Surely right here in Collin County as well, in forests along the rivers. We know their range. This was in their range. You can read the accounts of them. They were just so abundant. They would literally break the branch limbs off of trees. It's astonishing. We had our own parakeet, and it was here along the streams called the Carolina parakeet. And you can see its range well over into Texas. Well, today, almost all of the Blackland Prairie is gone. Unfortunately, the soil was so rich that you could make money off of it. And people plowed almost all of it up for cotton. There were a few small places that were kept as hay meadows. Those are being destroyed now. When I came to Grayson County 40 years ago, it was still some nice spots of Blackland Prairie, not much left. But we can still find its component plants. We can find it sometimes along railroad tracks. We can find it in a few places. We can find it along some roads that haven't been totally, the roadsides haven't been totally scraped. What are a few? I want to show you a few pictures of some of the plants. Probably the most abundant plant here in pre-settlement times is little bluestem. And little blue stem can look really different depending on the time of year. It can kind of look a bluish green, or it can be kind of a purplish almost, and it can turn kind of a reddish brown. This is what the inflorescences look like. So it can look very different depending on when you see it, but it's still very, very common. And any basically anywhere that has any native plants, you're going to find little blue stem. Many of you recognize these, big blue stem and Indian grass. The other of what's called the big four would be switchgrass. I didn't put a picture of that in. One of my favorites is the side oats grama, Boudaloo curtipendula, and that's the state grass of Texas. By the way, Indian grass is the state grass of Oklahoma. We have wonderful herbs in the Blackland Prairie. A number of different species of asclepias or milkweed. This is one called verticillata because the leaves are in a vertical or whorl. There's Asclepias viridis, and Rodney was talking about bumblebees. They like these guys. We all know this. And here's another. I love this milkweed, this orange milkweed. We know this guy who takes advantage of milkweeds. We have some things that are rare here. This is a plant that one of my students named a number of years ago. This is a hybrid baptisia. This is in the bean family. It's a hybrid between the blue baptisia and the yellow baptisia. And it's only known from two counties in Texas. And now it's been found in the Wichita Mountains. There's one location there. So it's only known from three places in the world. And we named it baptisia varicolor because it being a hybrid, it's weird because it can be, depending on the genetics, it's the same thing, but it can be various colors. It can go anywhere from this blue and yellow mix to a kind of a blue and red mix. It's a strange plant, but it's something very rare on the Blackland Prairie. Here's a wonderful little linum. Penstemon cobea, some of you know it. This is fortunately very common, but it's an Enothera. It's still pretty, even if it is common. That's mixed in. There's one mixed in with some bluebonnets. There's the Asclepias tuberosa. This little butterfly has an interesting color there. Drummond phlox. This is one that's native further east in the Blackland Prairie. It's a fairly rare member of the Blackland Prairie. This is Prairie Celestial. Prairie Celestial, to me, is what I called an indicator plant. And Jeff, you may say the same thing. If you see Prairie Celestial, you're probably going to say that has never been what? Wow. Never been plowed. That area's never been plowed. I've never seen Prairie Celestial where it's been plowed. The only place I've ever seen it is in an unplowed area. It's just not tolerant. It's not even tolerant of much grazing, is it? And it's a member of the iris family. I think it's one of the prettiest of our flowers. This, fortunately, is a tough thing. I have a lot of this growing in my little stored prairie up behind my house. It's a member of the sunflower family. It's prairie plantain, Cicalia plantaginifolia. It shoots up a thing about 3 feet high. Y'all know this. Some of you have seen it. Pretty common. Seeds blow in. It's wind dispersed. Coreopsis, another nice native. On the stream bottoms, we have Lobelia cardinalis. You can go down the streams here in the herd. You can see Lobelia cardinalis if you go at the right time of year. Quite a toxic plant, by the way. It used to be used medicinally. It was so dangerous because it would kill people. They stopped using it. Very, very toxic alkaloids. And of course, shooting star. Who doesn't like shooting star? And this thing has such wonderful natural history. Bumblebees come up and they vibrate their wings, but the wings they're not taking off. They vibrate, and the right vibration causes the pollen to fall out of the end of the anther. So the bumblebee is up and underneath, vibrated just the right frequency, and the pollen comes out and falls onto the bumblebee. The plant doesn't waste putting its pollen on other things. Isn't that a wonderful, close interaction between a plant and an animal? How about the future of the Blackland Prairie? Well, probably somewhere about 99.9% has been destroyed. And there's a lot of pressure on the remaining. Organizations like this one, or NAPA, or Native Prairie Association of Texas, or Nature Conservancy, or the Herd Museum, or Collin County. Collin County has some prairies, obviously. Many of you know about them. Austin College has a little restoration area. And one question I like to think about is, what obligation do we have to future generations? You know, we're among the last to probably be able to see much Blackland Prairie unless some of it is saved. And I like to end talks like this when I think about native plants and native vegetation. I like to end with about 5 minutes about another thing for the future. So I'm going through time now, right? I started 100 million years ago, and then I stopped at the end of the glacials. Well, now I'm going to jump ahead, maybe a few hundred years. I took this picture of Mount Kilimanjaro in, I think, 1992. This is a picture I pulled offline in 2006. That's where the glaciers were in 1992. That's where they were in 2006. Precious little left, and all the glacial ice is predicted to be gone by 2050. I think it's going to be before then because it's going so fast. This, to me, is one of the indicators of global climate change. I don't really like to call it global warming because it's a lot more than that. It's climate weirding, or we're getting more extremes. I don't need to tell you all this, right? We've had these polar vortexes coming down. We think that's due to the destabilization of the jet stream. So we're getting, you know, more regular heat, more days over 100. We're getting these cold excursions that are more common. I've thought about climate change for many years. I started being concerned about this decades ago. And so about 15 years ago, I decided I'm going to start going places and seeing things for myself. And I started going to the extreme north and the extreme south. So I've been to Antarctica. I've been to numerous expeditions to the Arctic. I've been across what's called the Northwest Passage. I've been up here all along the coast of Greenland. I've been to Iceland. I've been to Svalbard. Svalbard is the next thing to the North Pole. If you're going to the North Pole, some of the expeditions start at Svalbard and go from there. Svalbard is a group of islands. It's where the Millennium Seed Bank is, by the way. It's because it's permafrost. I've been to Svalbard. I've been up to 80 degrees latitude. Glaciers are melting everywhere. I've been to glaciers on 6 continents. When I was in Asia, I didn't have a chance to go to a glacier. Bummer. But I've been to glaciers, and they're melting everywhere. This is not an accident. This is in the Arctic. It's still cold. I got to climb up onto the Greenland ice cap. Greenland is changing in a shocking way. The Greenland ice cap is melting. And there's still a big ice cap there. This is some of the people I was with. It's just, you know, it's just ice and ice and ice. But this was a study that came out a few, and Greenland is a great big thing. If you plopped it down here, it would stretch from Canada down to Mexico, basically. The ice sheet is 3 times the size of Texas, and it could, you know, if all that ice melted, it would raise worldwide ocean levels somewhere around 20 feet. This was a study that came out. Greenland ice sheet has melted to a point of no return. That's not good news. This was a headline about a month ago, January 12th, 2023 was the warmest year on record, warmest year we've ever recorded since we had thermometers, okay? And then this is from a year ago, and at this point, this was a headline at the beginning of 2023, the last 8 years were the hottest on record. Now, the last 9 years have been the hottest on record. People could say, well, global warming isn't occurring, climate's not changing. What does the data say? As a scientist, I say, the last 9 out of 9 years are the warmest we've ever seen. Is that an accident? Is that just an accident? What's the chance? What's the probability? My wife's a mathematician. What's the probability of that happening? It's not great. This shows climate. This shows temperature, global mean estimates of climate of temperature. So this is after we got thermometers in the 1880s. We had thermometers before that, but we didn't have thermometers scattered all around the world so that it would be a reliable data. Okay, so but by the 1880s, the data weren't as good as now, but they weren't bad. And you can see global climate is complicated. And so it's kind of bounced up and down a lot. But if you look, the trend is obviously pretty clear. And you can see this most recent one. It's just shockingly higher last year than it has been. And on last two or three slides here, I didn't get to go to this glacier, but I went to one very close to it, and the same thing was happening. I love these paired photos. So people have been to some places and taken photos decades apart. And this is a great one. This is in southern South America. It's called Patagonia. It's almost like a mini ice cap there. And southern part of Chile and Argentina. And this is the Uppsala Glacier. And that's what it was like in 1928. That's the same place in 2004. You can't see that, but that's what it says. And you can see these same mountains, right? Are you convinced that's the same place? Pretty different, wouldn't you say? This is all glacier back then. This is showing what climate change does to vegetation. This is Memorial Day. And so we know when Memorial Day was. Memorial Day started out as a celebration for Civil War soldiers. And this picture was taken in Memorial Day. And I forget what day in the spring Memorial Day is. Anybody remember? Yeah, about 20, something like that. So this is what says right there, May 30. So that was 1868. And you can see that the only trees that had leaves were conifers. This was in 2005. And the trees are all leafed out. Vegetation responds to this kind of thing. There are all kinds of biological effects. There are effects on when plants leaf out, there are effects on flowering, there's effects on fruiting. These are not trivial. If plants flower at a certain time, what about the animals that pollinate them, that depend on them? These things get out of sync. What are the implications for Texas and for the Blackland Prairie? I can't tell you. I just think that it makes us think, what will be native? What will be able to grow here 100 years from now or 200 years from now? This part of Texas has changed in the past. It's going to continue to change, but it's kind of disturbing to think that we're exacerbating all of this. So thank you for your attention. I appreciate it. I'm happy to answer several questions if there's time. Tim, you can tell me if there's any time for questions.
Yeah, absolutely. And so let's start here. We have a question from, I would say we might want to mute that.
We do what?
Mute your speaker. Oh, well, no, I guess we can't. We can't. Sorry.
I can start.
There you go. All right, so the first question is about the mitigation area for the Bodark Reservoir, known as River Bee Ranch. If so, can you speak about the restoration effort going on there?
I cannot.
Okay.
Sorry.
All right.
And we have a gentleman who owns the property near there. Do you know anything about that?
I do, but I read it like a year ago, so my information is not updated. Okay. I mean, I've done a lot of work restoring and they have like full-time staff there at one point that were very knowledgeable, that were restoring it, and it was making great headway, and I meant to go out there and add it.
Okay. So somebody just had mentioned that they weren't aware of it, they weren't aware of the specifics other than as going on. So, all right. So from the virtual audience, do we have any questions for George? We'll let you guys go first. You can speak up or type it in the chat. Okay. Well, we're waiting for that. Anybody here? George, if you could repeat the question.
Okay. Yeah, the question was, are there any things on my mind that are on the brink of extinction right now? Most of the plants in the Blackland Prairie, in this part of the Blackland Prairie, are not endemic just to this area. There are more, if you look in Texas as a whole, where endemic plants are, that means plants that are only known from a certain part of the world. So we have many plants that are only known from Texas. We have a few plants that are known only from further south in the Blackland Prairie. I don't know of any that are right here. If we go a little ways west, we have some endemics. Almost any endemic is in danger of extinction because they have such a small range. I co-wrote a book with my colleague Barney Lipscomb a few years ago on Texas ferns and relatives, and a shocking percentage of ferns are ferns and their relatives are known from in Texas from one or two counties. They're either in the far northeast part of the state or in the far east, right adjacent to Louisiana, or they're in the Trans-Pecos. Some of them also occur in Mexico, some of them only on a few mountains in West Texas. But I don't know of any locally. The particular plant, and I'm biased because I've spent a lot of time studying it, that Baptisia is known from only, literally, there are three places. And one of them, fortunately, is a wildlife refuge. The two other places, though, are probably going to be destroyed. One is in northern Grayson County, and it's in an area that's growing like crazy. And the gentleman who owns it is very elderly, and I'm afraid its days are numbered. And then the Fannin County spot, they sprayed it because the farmer didn't like the weeds. And so they got most of those. So that Baptisia is one that I'm the one that's most on my mind. It's a good question. Yes.
Can I ask about the shooting stars and their what is it that causes them to be very sensitive?
What causes the shooting stars to be very delicate?
Well, no, to have such a limited range.
You know, I don't know. So, and I've often wondered that. It seems to be more common further west. Jeff, how much do you see it further west?
LBJ, Wise County, Cook and Monte County, they seem to be on limestone seeps.
So it's quite a bit.
Yeah.
I think, I don't know in Grayson County, so much of, because of the way the Blackland Prairie was here, much of it was simply plowed up. And then a lot of it has been contoured. So because cotton, you know, when cotton was being grown here in large amounts, people didn't really understand soil erosion. They didn't understand contour plowing. And so there was horrifying erosion. And for example, part of our Sneed property, bulldozers were brought in, this is long before we had it, and contoured the land to keep it from continuing to erode. And so I think probably some of the limestone seeps in this area were probably bulldozed away, is my guess. I don't, the place where I found it in Grayson County is literally up along the Red River, right below a rock layer, and water can seep down, just like Jeff was saying, in a limestone seep. And it's where it couldn't have been plowed because it's steep. And it's right, you couldn't put a plow on the ground there anyway because it's rock. But I don't know why there's so little, other than probably it took a special subhabitat. And there's not much of that subhabitat survived around.
We have a question here from the audience. How many species are found throughout the Blackland Prairie? What are considered indicator species for the Blackland Prairie?
So, I don't know of anybody who has ever done a calculation of the total number of species on the Blackland Prairie. When we did the floor of North Central Texas, there was somewhere, I forget the exact number now, that book was written, believe it or not, published 25 years ago. I was young then. and it was written in, you know, a few years preceding that. But there were 2,400 species known from North Central Texas. Most of those were from the Blackland Prairie, because I would count the forests that come through on the streams to be part of it. So I would say, now some of those were a little bit to the west of here, but I would say probably approaching 2,000 species would be how many roughly on the Blackland Prairie, but I don't have an exact number.
An indicator species for the Blackland Prairie is?
Yeah, so an indicator species, that's actually also quite a good question, because when you look at the Blackland Prairie, there are subtypes of vegetation. So they're depending on how much moisture there is, there can be different collections of grasses. So in some moisture areas, you may have more of what's called eastern gamma grass. It's another large grass, and it tends to be in the wetter areas of the prairie. And you often have different herbs growing with some of the grasses that are in wetter areas. Many of the indicators, to me, I can't. Most of the grasses are very widespread, so many of the herbs are indicator species to me, because they seem to be very sensitive. Grasses are pretty tough. It's hard to kill most grasses unless you graze them and graze them and graze them, or you simply totally plow them up. Many of the herbs, though, are much more sensitive to grazing. So I mentioned the Nema stylus. That's one. And there are a bunch of herbs like that. There are some of the shooting stars that are pretty pretty limited, and they're indicator species. So there are a lot of the what I would call forbs, little members of the bean, some members of the bean family that are pretty good indicators. If you see them, it's a good chance that the prairie has not been plowed. Jeff, what are some of your indicators? Yeah, Baptisia, we saw that. That is a good indicator. Rattlesnake master is a ringo. Some of you know the purple ringo, and rattlesnake master is a relative of that.
Maybe compass plant.
Compass plant would be a good one.
How about blue hearts? Are they further west
mostly? I can't remember the range. That's a good question. Carol, you probably know some other indicators here. Yeah.
Camassia, I guess.
Camassia. Yeah. That's a good one.
And maybe death camas as well.
Mm-hmm. Death camas. Yeah. Or grazing. You can you gnaw those off a few times and they're yeah.
Another question is, somebody wants to know more about soil churn. Are there particular plants that we can look out for that favor growing in the depressions that might help see them for some untrained eyes?
You know, that's a great question. And I used to take students over to the prairie in Hunt County, the Nature Conservancy prairie. The name has jumped out of my mind. Climber. I used to take students over there with a long field trip from Austin College, but we'd drive over and that's where we did sample. But that was like 20 years ago. And for the life of me, I can't remember what was in the Gilgai, in the little depressions versus on the outside. So I simply, what can I say? I can't remember. But it's an interesting question.
Mm-hmm. And then on the rims, you got things like cider and scramble that like
mm-hmm.
a little bit drier.
Yeah.
And I think I learned this from your book.
And I've slept since I wrote that.
All right, any other questions? I just had a basic question on management of transitioning a property. So I want to use livestock. To what degree is that an appropriate tool? And what are the kind of, if it is an appropriate tool, what are the parameters on that that would help, that would make it so you could use livestock as a tool to transition an area to prairie, more native prairie, as opposed to the, you know, bahia grass, Bermuda grass? Because when I go to the NRCS, they tell me if they want to cost share, or if I want them to cost share a native planting on my property, I have to spray the entire place with herbicide 4 or 5 times throughout the year, kill everything, and then I can plant the natives. I don't want to do that.
Right. Because you probably have some natives already.
I do have some natives already. And then just...
So this is a complicated question. And Austin College has a site called the Sneed Prairie Restoration, and we have plots set up that get different treatments. And this is an experiment that's been going on now for many years. Some back in the 80s, a family gave us 100 acres, and we've been trying, and a small snippet of it was unplowed native prairie. Most of it had been pretty badly eroded. And so there are different treatments given to different sections. And for example, some were mowed, some were burned, some were grazed. And there are actually publications on how successful some of those have been. And you have to have some kind of disturbance. If you use cattle, you've got to be pretty careful because even the native grasses can only stand being eaten down. They can't stand that very many times because they store energy in the roots, right? And if you eat them down and then they sprout back up and you eat them down again, you soon use up all the stored energy and the plant dies. And that's ultimately what happens. So we're lucky that there's a neighbor across the road from us and we use his cattle occasionally. So we'll run his cattle, we run into our property and they stay there just very short amount of time and you knock back the standing biomass. That's important because prairie grasses evolved in a disturbance regime. And if you don't do something, they'll choke themselves out. They will literally smother themselves. So if you get all this dead biomass, let's say if you have big blue stem, little blue stem, and they just grow up and there's no mowing, there's no fire, there's no grazing. The next spring, light's not going to get down there. And so you're not going to get the appropriate amount of growth. So they have to have some kind of disturbance. I can hook you up with a gentleman who's in charge of that project, and they've actually published those results, and you can look and see which of these treatment options you think you might feel best about. We've done all kinds of things. We've planted various grasses. I've done some planting on my own property. I've had most success planting Indian grass from seed. It's remarkable how well Indian grass does from seed. Tony, have you done that?
Almost to a point where it took over other grasses.
Yeah. And there are some grasses, I don't want to poison everything either, because I have a lot of native little blue stem, but I also have a lot of KR blue stem, which, as you know, some of you know, it's called King Ranch blue stem. And it was brought in, I think it's African. It was brought into the King Ranch down in southern Texas. And now it's spread everywhere. I've come to peace with KR blue stem because I just decided I don't want to kill my natives. And I'm not going to get the KR blue stem out of there. And God bless it, it's a tough plant. And you know, I love all plants. It might not be where it's supposed to be, but I don't want to wipe out. Now, no love between me and Johnson grass. I'll kill Johnson grass whenever I can. If it's possible, I kill it. Yeah, it's a lot easier than KR. And it's, you know, KR is, I think, a less obnoxious plant than Johnson grass, too. Yeah. So I think, you know, you have to kind of pick your battles when you're trying to restore. You don't want to sterilize your soil, but, you know, we can't go back to the way things were. And so I think we can do the best we can, given certain limitations. You probably don't want to use huge amounts of pesticide. You don't want to spray three or four. You don't want to contaminate yourself. You don't want to contaminate your soil and your animals. And it's just not worth it. You know, I'm not going to be going out spraying a bunch of stuff. Bill and Fran here have done a lot of restoration. What, you guys have had more hands-on experience than I have. Any advice?
I think I feel the same way you do about KR and Johnson. It's going to be around a lot longer than we're going to be. You just try to keep it at bay to a certain extent. At least that's what I come. Yeah, I was thinking maybe if you want to ask about grazing practices, maybe was Tony Maxwell still with extension agent?
Yeah,
I know.
Yeah,
I'm going to
ask him. And Chad
Cummings
in your county is very knowledgeable.
I'd like to add a thing or two. I go to a lot of wildlife management seminars, and there's some good wildlife management advisors that will tell you differently how to work on that. And also, if you check over at Leela and ask them how they build their little restoration areas one little piece at a time, you might find that more of interest. They burn a brush pile, and then they plant plants that already have roots right into the ash and give them a sort of a seed bank for just only spread out from those here. They've had a lot of success in their areas.
Every spring I go to Oak Point and get some Vanagrass cuttings. just a little, I'm not going to spread out all plants, but just a little cutting here and there, and I take it. I took those cuttings this spring of 22. They survived that entire drought and well, through the next year.
I'm trying to see,
and I didn't water at all.
Burn pops, but that hasn't worked. So maybe
we've seeded a couple and we've had mixed results. One of our spots, we had some stuff, but it's like it took 2 years before we noticed some of the stuff that was coming up. That's not, but again, those are kind of few and far between. We haven't had a ton of the brush fires. So.
I think this is interesting. I think, Carol, you and I may be thinking the same thing. Many native plants, you don't expect to see a lot of things coming up every year. There are certain years where the conditions seem to be right for particular plants. I'm always shocked. One year, Coreopsis will just go crazy. And the next year, there'll be something else that there's lots of. Is that
your... I have to agree with that. We've got some acreage and I watch it and see what's going on up there. It's been almost 20 years now, but
you will get different things dominating. And when you think about rainfall and drought cycles and things like that, that has a lot to do with it, but it might not be last month's rain
exactly.
Or even, you know, 4 months ago's rain. It might have been the previous year's rain where it was building roots and then it's going to put on a great show the next year. So you have to think, you know, it's related to the rainfall patterns, but on a longer scale than I think we're used to thinking about.
That's a great comment.
Let me get to a question from the audience or from the virtual audience. Is the Austin College Prairie Restoration Site open to the public?
It's not, in a sense, yes, and in a sense, no. So we take groups of grade school kids out there, and it's a program that's been going on for many years. And I forget now that they've taken 1,000 or 1,500 grade school kids, and we've gotten grants. And so we take the public out there. If somebody wants to see it, they're interested, they can contact us and they can contact me and I can set them up with somebody, the person who's in charge. And it's easy to find my information online. If you just,
I think one last question.
Bill had a comment.
Oh, sorry. George, this is a little bit off of grasses, but we're talking about oak trees. You know, this year, a so-called master year, that's Benny Acre and Seuss, you know, I've seen you in the what accounts for that?
So Bill is asking about a phenomenon some people call mass fruiting or MAST, or some people call it mass, MASS. There are many trees that have irregular amounts of seeds produced. So there'll be a year where the plant produces lots of seeds. Then there may be several years where they produce very few seeds. It does not seem to be necessarily tied to good growing conditions. It may be partially tied to that. What we think is going on, and I can't swear to this, but what we think is going on is it's an evolutionary strategy to avoid seed predators. So if you make yourself a resource, in this case, a food resource, that is irregular in time, it's more difficult for a predator, in this case, something that would eat the seeds, it makes it more difficult for a predator to evolve a life cycle that takes advantage of. So we see that, for example, in pecans. We see it in oaks. Pecans are a wonderful example of it because, you know, it'll be a great year. You think I'm going to get a great crop of pecans and it's a dud, right? So we see it in pecans. There are other, I'm going to go down a rabbit hole now, but I think it's worthwhile. There are other examples in nature where things are a rare resource. And the most extreme example of this I know of are on the periodic cicadas. These are these, I grew up calling them locusts. Y'all might have too, but they're these cicadas and they have 17-year cycles and some have 14-year cycles and some have 7-year cycles. But the long ones are 17-year cycles. They live underground eating the roots of trees for as larvae for something like, you know, usually 17 years. And then they all come out at once. And I grew up in the eastern deciduous forest. And boy, when I was about 10, it was a cicada year. We call it a locust year. It was unbelievable because we were in the forest and they were deafening. I see it nodding. You experienced the same thing. You know, it'd be very hard for something to evolve to be a specialist predator if you're only around once every 17 years. It makes it really tough. And if the resource, in this case, the large numbers or mass fruiting is irregular, 17 years is regular, but in the case of the plants, it's irregular. It makes it less likely for you to have all your seeds eaten because the predator population can't build up. There are other things like this. And there's another one, and I'm really going down a rabbit hole here, but to me, it's fascinating. If you go to the Serengeti in Africa, there's this creature called the wildebeest. Everybody's seen them on the nature shows, right? The herds of, you can look and see thousands, tens of thousands of them. the females all have their babies in something like a 2-week period. It's unbelievable. It's like the females just, and there's a jillion little wildebeest. And the little wildebeest are able to be up and running, well, not fast, but they're up moving around in about 20 minutes. It's thought that they have synchronized into one period of time, because if the female wildebeest were having babies all through the year, when they're little, they're easy to catch. If we were lions, we'd just stroll out and
get a baby wildebeest anytime we wanted one. It would be like a popsicle. But
if they're all born at once, the lions can only eat so many at once. And within a matter of literally a few weeks, they're pretty fast. And, you know, so it's a way to, I like to think of this as things evolving in a temporal sense to avoid predators. Now, it's a different example. The wildebeest, all at once, they overwhelm the predators, okay? But it's I think of this temporal evolution. In the case of the cicadas and the Cape mass fruiting, it's you make yourself rare in time versus, you know, a glut in time. But it's the same kind of idea. It's a good defense strategy. You know, creatures have evolved all kinds of defenses, right? Poisonous plants, physical armature. There's a lot of ways creatures defend themselves. Camouflage versus speed, you know, armature in animals, you know, tortoises and porcupine. There's all kinds of ways to defend themselves, and evolving in a temporal sense is another defense mechanism. So, Bill, sorry, I took that question and went down three rabbit holes. All at once, by golly.
It's a little off subject, but I
want to. All right. Well, I think we will end it there, George. Thank you so much. Really appreciate the talk.
A pleasure. Thank you.
Well, thank you, everyone, for joining us.
Thanks to you, virtual folks.
Have a good night.